Okay. I just want to let you guys know that at the Life Point building, always when I come in there, there will be five angels. There's always five angels. There was always one standing in the middle of the building, out very high, and there will be four on the corner posts. And this afternoon when we came in here, they were standing here, the exact same angel. So please just understand that it's really not about a building.
Right.
It's about a company of people.
Yes.
And these angelic, they are assigned to a company of people.
Yes.
It is part of what God establishes in the ecclesia. It is that which we believe, that's what we run after, that these angelic entities are assigned to. Okay, so just realize that. And I'm excited about what I believe God wants to do today. He's taken me to a new place at least every month. I can literally feel a shift taking place in my sight, in my hearing, in what I achieve, and what I'm doing in the spirit. And it's freaking me out most of the time because there's not a lot of people I can go to and speak to about it. There's not a lot of people that I can ask questions regarding what I'm seeing, what I'm experiencing. So I kind of have to just look it up myself. I listen to my mentors over and over and over again to see if there's anything that they say that has answers to what I'm seeing and what I'm experiencing. Sometimes a little bit, sometimes nothing. So even in what I'm sharing today, I just need you to grasp it. I need you to take hold of it because it's so in our perception on, well, this is my destiny and I have to do what they tell me to do. This is what they told me to do. So a lot of what we do in our walk with God is what we've perceived through what others have told us to do. So it sounds really great, you know, casting out demons, raising the dead, healing the sick, cleansing the lepers. That's what we perceive out of the word, what we have to do, and that's what we do. And so we just kind of follow our leaders and what they tell us to go do. Now, I believe there's a time and a season for all of us to go through that process of learning and getting to that place where I do exactly what the Father has destined for me to do. But in that process, I adapt a lot of poop.
Yeah.
And the problem is really getting rid of that poop. Once the Father has given me my destiny, so once He's given me the fullness of what I need to walk in, how do I get rid of my perception of what He's told me to do? Because if He's told me to do something in one way, and I have a specific way of doing that through the perception that was allocated to me through what I used to do, then I'm going to do what He told me to do my way, and it's not going to be the right way. It's called works of iniquity. So what I'm going to try and do today is I'm going to try and get you to the place where you understand your destiny scroll is waiting for you in the kingdom of heaven, where you literally have to go and fetch it.
Yes.
And it's that process of understanding and revelation that you, as a son of God, and I need you to understand when I say son of God, I'm not talking to babies. I'm not talking to somebody that is still a slave to Jesus. I'm not talking to somebody that's even a bondservant of Jesus. I'm talking to a son and a daughter that has matured and has grown in the kingdom of heaven. That's no longer occupying their faith in the earth, but has taken it into the kingdom of heaven and is operating out of that realm as the Father is growing you in your sonship so that you can become a king.
Amen.
So that you can become a priest. So that you can literally be the oracle of God so that when you speak, it is Him speaking.
Yes, right.
When you lift your hands, it's Him lifting His hands. It's that dimension that dimensional shift that takes place when you become one with Him. Now, I can't become one with Him in the natural. Because my natural perception of the natural is flesh. That's why I can't even perceive the fact that husband and wife is one. Because of my natural perception of being one. Don't look at me with that tone. This is real. It's true. Okay? But in the spirit, it's a different thing. I remember a long time ago, I was smoking a cigarette. Very long time ago. I was smoking a cigarette and I was driving in the car. And while I had a cigarette in my mouth. Now, when you have a cigarette in your mouth, then there's a certain type of smoke that comes out in the front. And then when you blow the cigarette, the smoke out of your mouth, it's a different type of smoke. I guess it's already gone down, stuffed up your lungs, and now it's coming out of your mouth going, woohoo! But it's different, and so what happened to these two different types of smokes, it kind of mingled, and it became one and went up and out the window. And immediately the Lord said to me, that's how I want you to be one with me. God used cigarettes? No. What God are you, sir? But it was just the beginning for me to perceive that the one that he wants from me is not in my natural perception of flesh becoming flesh. Because even in the natural perception of flesh becoming flesh, there's a dimension of becoming one that I understand, but then there's also a separation. So it's not something that's consistent and that stays one. But when I step into the Spirit and I allow him to begin to take over every dimension and every area of my life, then all of a sudden there's a shift in my perception of how to become one with him. Now, I've said this and shared this a couple of times already because it was for me a new revelation, so I'm all excited. But the Father has really made something clear to me. In the beginning, he gave dominion over to man. He created the earth, and he gave everything over to man.
Yes.
Right? You believe this?
Yes.
So the earth, the kingdom of earth belongs to man. We were given dominion and authority, so everything that happens in the face of the earth, don't look at me with that tone, is my fault, and it's in my hands. Whatever I need to change, whatever that needs to change, is in my hands. I can change it. He's given me everything I need. He's opened every door that needs to be opened through the blood of Yeshua. I have all authority, all power to shift anything and everything into line as I ought to. Whatever the enemy has taken, I have the authority to take back. Whatever the enemy is occupying, it's only occupying it because the sons of God haven't taken that space. That's why we have a perception that there's a kingdom of darkness. There's not a kingdom of darkness, there's a kingdom in darkness. Okay, so as the light and the fullness of the light, our responsibility is to take back the kingdom that's in darkness and put it in the light. Okay, so that everything that we think belongs to Satan, anything we believe that belongs to the New Age, anything we think belong to them, whatever, we take back because it does not belong to them. It is always meant to be ours. Satan just perverted it and dressed it in such a way that the sons of God don't want it because that's what we were taught. Okay, so when we begin to understand that he created the kingdom of earth, and gave it all to me. Every area of it belongs to me. He gave it over to me. Then there's the second kingdom, the kingdom of God. How many understand? The kingdom of God, according to the word of God, is inside of me. And what happens there is it belongs to me. I create the kingdom of God. Do you understand that? I allow into this body what I choose to allow in. No one can force anything into me unless he's shooting me with a bullet or a knife. But in this body, whatever goes into it, whether McDonald's, whether Kentucky, whether Canes, whether alcohol, whether drugs, whether something healthy, whether whatever you choose to bring into this, is your choice. No one can force anything onto you. Right, so this kingdom belongs to me. And now the Father's desire because of the first is that I make the decision like he made the decision. How many understand it was a very scary decision for God? Maybe it's just because I'm saying it and I'm thinking if I was God, I would go, no way. But it must have been a scary decision because he looked at our perceptions, he looked at where we act, and he realized that it's going to be a process for us to run and to bring the earth back into its fullness after we've been restored through the blood of Yeshua. Okay, so well, this belongs to me, the kingdom of God. I have to come in my life to a decision where I give everything over to him. Just like in the first, he gave everything over to me. I haven't taken anything back. But now in this kingdom where it's kingdom of God, I have to make a decision in my life where every aspect, every area, every domain, every dimension, every realm within me, I give over to him. So that he rules and reigns in everything, where he has dominion over me, he has full authority over me, I am submitted to him 100%. That's the second kingdom. Then we've got the third kingdom, which is the kingdom of heaven. That's the full supply. That's the where the Father said we are sitting with Yeshua in our heavenly places. That's the second kingdom. That's where we are co-heirs with him. So as the first kingdom, he given us to run. The second kingdom, we've given to him to run. The third kingdom, we run together. And the third kingdom is that dimension, that kingdom that establishes all the other kingdoms into its full place and shifts everything into its place of perfection. So whatever I want in the second kingdom as the kingdom of God, I need to go fetch it and the fullness of it in the kingdom of heaven. Whatever I want in the earth, this kingdom, I need to go into the kingdom of heaven, the third heaven, to go fetch it there. So it begins the process of my understanding that for me to receive whatever I want in this life and the fullness of it, because if Yahweh, or Yeshua, has full dominion over my body, soul, and spirit, then he has allocated to me personally certain things that I have to do because he's made me unique and I'm authentic. Authentically created in his image. So he has set apart specific things for me to do in this and in the earth. And of course in the kingdom of heaven. So I need to begin to understand that there's certain things that needs to shift. There's a dimension of intimacy. There's a dimension of relationship and worship that needs to take place in my life to such an extent that the church cannot be the place where I come to receive. I need to understand that if you come to church to receive, you are being accused by me of vampirism. Where you're coming to suck the life out of God's people. Because I walk in here and some sons and daughters walk in here full with the Spirit, full with the glory, because we've been in the kingdom of heaven. We come back and we bring that glory into the room. That's how it's supposed to be. There's some that comes in here weak, drowned, completely hungry, starving, having nothing, and just sucking up what's in the air. And then say, oh, the presence of God is so wonderful, yeah. But the idea has always been that I come into a meeting, especially when it's the ecclesia coming together. It is the fullness of his glory that gathers, because that's where we live and move and have our being. That's why the earth shakes when the sons and daughters come together with the right understanding of what happens. He has given me full dominion. I have given him full dominion. Together we run the kingdoms with the establishment of all that which needs to come in place. That's why he's got different scrolls in the kingdom of heaven. That's why there's books written for the sons and the daughters. In the Bible, I believe it talks about three books. It talks about the scroll of destiny, the book of life, and the scroll of life. I know it talks about the book of tears, it talks about book of wars, and I guess in perception there's many thousands of books that we just haven't perceived yet. I mean, let's think about it. Paul goes into the kingdom of heaven, spends time there, comes back and says, you know, the things I saw I can't utter. Now, I just want to remind you that he couldn't utter it because he couldn't perceive it. It wasn't illegal for him to speak of it. Although he said it was unlawful for me to utter, what he really meant to say was, I had no clue what I saw up there. And if I even understood what I saw and tried to explain it to you, I would sound like John. Because I need to understand what John said. Never. Because he sees a locust dressed in armor. Yeah, but can you imagine a locust in armor? No, but that's his perception, right? So imagine what Paul, in his perception of that day, saw in the kingdom of heaven and has no time and space. There's no time allocated in the sense of, well, that was the 60s, and in the year 2007 they dressed like this, but the year 1 they dressed in that way, and so that's the season, that's the time, and that's the revelation. It wasn't nothing like that. So he comes with a perception, and he can't utter it, because in this time, in his walk with Yahweh, wouldn't make any sense to the ones that he's leading. So he knows that that was allocated for another time and another season, a day such as this. But so what he could perceive and could understand, he wrote down, and it became 3/4 of the New Testament.
Come on.
So just begin to understand what's left for me to go fetch. How many scrolls, how many more books there is that the sons and the daughters can go into the kingdom of heaven, fetch, because that's the blueprint that we need to open to reflect that which is there back into the earth. Am I losing you guys?
No.
Focus. Hold onto your chair. If you fall asleep, shift from your soul into your spirit. Because the reason you're falling asleep is because you're soulish. Now that sounds really terrible, but it's okay. So your soul is not bad. I love my soul. My soul is so cute. My soul is completely retarded most of the time. If my spirit goes, my soul goes, what? Oh my God, did it just say you spoke that out in public? People hurt you, rababahim. Stop it. The idea that my soul changes, my soul needs to begin to perceive the things that my spirit has made available, right? So, if you feel you're nodding off, it's because your soul is kind of taking over. So just pinch yourself a little bit every now and then and shift back into the spirit. Okay, that's why we worship before we start preaching, so that you can stay in the spirit, because you can't worship unless you're in the spirit. How many of you know that? And if you want to worship me in spirit. If you're worshiping me anywhere else, just skafafing. Skafafing is just a word I made up. Yeah. Okay, so there's a record of your eternal destiny. Now, I want you to understand something. Your eternal destiny is it's something that we don't perceive because it goes behind my death. Now, I still say death because there's still a perception in the church of death, so we still believe that we have to die. So for as long as you believe that, that's what you're going to have. Right, because scientifically we're not supposed to die. And I've shared this before, it's literally been proven that the human body has been designed to completely regenerate itself every 7 years.
Come on.
So why we're dying is blaming it on our God. Actually, we can blame it on anything and everything we eat. As a matter of fact, if you were a Jew, you would quickly understand that we can blame anything and everything because anything and everything is sin. Do you know that? And it's only because of what's in the earth. Because after the sin that took place in the garden, all of that went into the earth and brought destruction. That's why we have corrosion, sand, death. That's why things die. And that includes everything we eat. Okay? And of course, they put all kinds of steroids and all kinds of rubbish in our foods. So you think you're eating healthy, but in the meantime, you're not. I mean, when we came from South Africa to America, we ate the exact same food as what we did in South Africa, and yet we picked up weight. Because it's not the same. There's all kinds of other stuff in there that shouldn't be in it. So I need you to understand something. As much as my spirit is important, as much as my soul is important, my body is also important. Matter of fact, the Lord made it very clear to me while I'm preaching and teaching and stuff. He said, if you're beginning to walk in the glory that I want to give to your body, you need to look after it more. Because for me to step into a glorified dimension where my being becomes glorified, I cannot have the mentality anymore because the revelations for today, I cannot believe that death is my savior. I can no longer believe that I have to die to be glorified. I have already died.
Come on.
Are you guys okay?
Yes.
I have already died, so the life I now live, I live in Christ. Matter of fact, I even have his faith. I'm completely and utterly closed in Him. It's no longer any dimension because I've given dominion and authority over to Him. This kingdom belongs to Him. Just like this kingdom belongs to me. And so when we are reigning together, all that He's given me from this dimension is eternal. And for me to be reminded that I have the authority and the power to bring the eternal to this dimension, yeah, and to fill this with all of what God has. If they sit in the earth, He's not going to come and remove it. If they sit in the earth, and we want a 1,000 years, then we have to establish that from the kingdom of heaven. And how are we going to establish that? By beginning to walk in the authority. By beginning to understand that there's demonic power, principalities, rulers, and powers and principalities in the earth that's there today, only but because the sons of God have not seen them. Because let me promise you, once they are seen, we have the ability to eliminate them. But we don't walk in the earth. spiritually. Now, in the same breath, I wouldn't suggest you go walk to and fro because actually that's Satan's job. But if that's Satan's job, is that what he does, then it must be a perversion of the original. But it's no longer his job to walk to and fro, seeking who he may devour. Really seriously, dude, you're under my feet. Only thing you can devour is my toe jam. And if we have any other mentality than just that, then he will be over you and he will destroy you because we have got this mentality that I have to war him. I don't understand that anymore, although it has been a belief of mine, but the Bible says he's defeated.
Come on.
He's disarmed. So there's a dimension somewhere that we've missed because we still want to bind him, we want to lose him. The poor guy doesn't know what to do. We go, we bind him, and then we lose him, and then we tell him to go, and we tell him to come, and then we wake up in the morning and we start speaking to every demon attached to him, and it's all this massive festival of communication with the demons, and before we know it, we're under attack. And so we get all under attack, and we think we're being spiritual, and it's good, I'm under attack because I'm so powerful in the spirit realm. No, you're under attack because you're engaging with the demonic. That's why there's a mobile court. That's why the fathers allocated the mobile court to the sons and the daughters of the Most High. And it's not a new thing. It's been there since Job. But I remind you, Satan cannot get into the kingdom of heaven. He only has a rule on the earth. And he can only do what I allow him to do.
Come on.
Do you guys believe that?
Yes.
So the idea eventually is that we close every gate and close every door that he has authority over. Because every door and every gate that he occupies needs to be replaced with the Prince of Orient Angel that has a mandate for cities, towns, nations, and that has to be accomplished through the sons of God. It's not just going to happen because we ask Yahweh to do it for us. Now he is not an absent God. So that's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying that he's an absent God who wants us to do everything. Yeah. No, he's never created us to be apart from him in any way, fashion, or form. He, in a matter of fact, doesn't want to do anything without you.
Come on.
That's why his desire for you is to begin to understand. That's why the Bible tells us that the whole of creation is waiting for the sons of God.
Come on.
Exciting, isn't it?
Yes.
Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book, your scroll, were all written the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there has not been one of them. I want to remind you of something, that before you were born, and this is the Father's heart, and I don't know why we don't perceive this, because we know him, but we don't understand this one thing. He's never going to force you to anything. Which means he doesn't have something written down for you that you have not agreed to.
Right.
Which means your destiny and the fullness of your destiny, whether it's your purpose on the earth, whether it is your eternal purpose and your eventual eternal destiny, it is all written down according to what you agreed upon.
Right?
So in essence, in reality, if I agreed upon that which is given to me to do in the earth, then I must have agreed with it before I came into my mother's womb.
Right.
And if what has already been given to me is there for me to go fetch, but it's in the kingdom of heaven, and I remind you that Yeshua was slain before the foundation of the earth. That's why Enoch could go and do what he did. That's why Elijah could do what he did. That's why David could do what he did. That's why Moses could do what he did. That's why all these men could go in and out and do what they did, because everything has been available from the very beginning. It's always been available. The timeline is not horizontal. It's vertical. Everything's happening at the same time. Don't look at me with that tone. That's why on the Mount of Transfiguration, those three men from different eras could have been there at the same time. I need you to begin to understand the Father's called you to know exactly what to do. You know, for years, my ministry was to prophesy over everybody, to preach a message, and then to prophesy, to lay hands on people, and to do just what my pastor did. That's all I knew. And every other preacher that I've ever known, that's what they did, so that's what I did. And I felt really empty, because it just wasn't what I wanted to do, but it's what I could do, so I thought, well, if I don't do it, then I'm robbing the bride, so I'm just going to have to do it.
That's
But then the Father showed me my destiny storm. He didn't show me the whole thing. He showed me a timeline in which he's going to do specific things, and that's what I needed to do. And after I've seen it, it immediately started falling into place. But I had to go. James made a statement that we have to remind ourselves of every now and then. Faith without works is dead. It's not a contradiction to him saying that all your good deeds is like filthy rags before me. It's not a contradiction. It's different works. Because for me to take my faith and what I believe and what I perceive the Father wants to do, I have to work at it. I can't just go through my day without spending intimate time with him. I can't make the intimate time work. I have to begin to understand that my spirit needs to grow over and above my soul and my body to such an extent that my spirit can begin to remember that which it agreed to. And so once I start going into the kingdom of heaven and I allow my spirit being to see, and let me tell you something, for me personally it's become very clear and it's grown over the last 5 years, so we've got a 5-year-old teaching you, I hope you enjoy it. Over the last 5 years my sight has changed so many times. In the beginning it was really difficult, but I had to imagine everything. And it fell to my perception that what I'm imagining is just my imagination. But I praise God that I began to realize that it's not my imagination. Although I'm imagining it, I don't even like that word. I think it's a ridiculous word because it really sounds like something you make up. But I can't change the word because someone thought of it and wrote it down. So now it's there. But as much as it's my imagination, it's really my spirit that's doing it because I invited soul and spirit. So my spirit's free in the kingdom of heaven to do all that which just needs to be done. Because there's many things. As a matter of fact, I was driving here earlier today. We were driving here. And while I was driving, I literally saw my spirit man walking with the Father, multiplied into 7, walking with a different 7 spirits. And I could hear and feel the 7 different teachings that was going on all at the same time while I was spending time with Yahweh, the fullness of Yahweh, in a specific place in the Garden of Eden. My spirit was in a different place, but yet in the same place, just multiplied over different areas. How do you perceive that? How do you understand that? My soul was not aware of all of that. It became aware of it as I was focused and began to engage what I believe my spirit is doing. It's a process of growth that I, as the Son of God, have to walk into. Because the sight will change, just like tongues. How many remember when you just started speaking in tongues? Yeah. I mean, for me, it was hilarious. It was just really funny because I only had one word. It was a parakatishan. I had to say it over and over and over and over again for a long time. And then I got another word. Sharakabanda. I had a parakatishan sharakabanda for a very long time. And I had to, by faith, just say it over and over and over again. And it was really irritating because if you say it in Afrikaans and you take some of those words, it sounds really ridiculous. Because parakatish is frog. Para is a frog in Afrikaans. A dish is a pan. So I'm saying frog in a pan, frog in a pan. So this is my soul trying to fight this out. Really, you're saying frog in a pan in front of everybody? And then, of course, kara sabanda is really terrible because it's cars tires. Kara is cars and banda is tires. So I was frog in a pan and it's cars tires. I said, Lord, you'd rather let me say Yamaha, Kazuki, Katana. But it just makes more sense. It sounds more tongues. But then all of a sudden, one day, out of just doing that by faith, was just flowing around me. And it works, I believe, exactly the same with sight, with hearing, with seeing, with perception, with revelation. Just, you have to, by faith, push in and believe and see. And then one day, just as you've been walking faithfully, it starts pouring into you in the full dimension that you need. Because the Father's desire for the kingdom of heaven is for it to be so real like this. Now, I'm not completely there yet, but sometimes I don't know whether I'm in the spirit or in the flesh. When I sit in the mornings and it's just me, myself, and I, and hopefully the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and the 100 million angels are enthroned, I literally see all kinds of movements. And if it began, it was just lights. I don't know if you understand when you see lights and different colored lights, it's angels. And that's how I perceived it in the beginning, but nowadays, I literally see a movement and I'm like, whoa, what was that? I have to get up to go see if there was actually someone there, because it begins to be so real. I remember lying on my couch for the engagement of the Father, and I could see the two kingdoms engaging in one, and literally becoming one. I was standing in the gym the other day, and I was doing pull-ups, and when I came down, for those of you who know that if you do a hard exercise, I mean, I'm 300 pounds, doing pull-ups, quite a hectic exercise for me. And when I came down, I was a little bit dizzy, and I was engaging with the Father, and while I was kind of trying to focus what I'm seeing in front of me, the two kingdoms became one to such an extent that I started hearing the buzzing, like thousands of people talking and interacting with each other, and I started seeing the angelic realm just engaged in the kingdom of heaven, just really popping out in the earth where I was standing inside the gym. Thousands of angels just talking to each other, just phenomenal stuff in between what I see in the natural and in the spirit. And so I need you to begin to understand the Father's desire for you is to know that as you push in, as you persevere, as you go deeper, as you dig into Him, He's going to reveal more to you.
Yes.
So what you know today might not really get you to the things that I'm talking about today, but if there's a destiny scroll in the kingdom of heaven, the court of scrolls, then maybe it's waiting for you to get it.
Come on.
That I was lying on the floor in a Life Point church before it got flooded. And I remember I was taken into a courtroom. Now, I didn't exactly know what it looked like. I wouldn't say it was a courtroom per se, because there wasn't a judge or anything. That's what I saw. When I went into this room, it was just excessively big, very high walls, thousands of scrolls, little blocks like this with scrolls inside of it. Some had like a book rack with books in it, and it was just millions and millions, and there was some angelic presence, there were some creatures, sentient beings. There was just a lot of stuff happening there, but I remember I was directed to a specific spot, and the scroll just came out the wall and came right into me. I knew it was my scroll, my name was written on it, and at first I didn't understand it, I couldn't read it. And I had it in me for quite a while, and then I was busy worshiping, and I went to the Father and presented myself as a living sacrifice to Him at the throne of grace. And while I was doing that, it all became clear. It was literally like a movie scene playing in front of me. I saw my spirit enhanced and expanded over a specific place. I believe it was the hub that I would do it from. And then from there, my spirit would just go into different cities in the same state, and then it would go into a new state, and into different cities, into a new state, into different cities. My one spirit just multiplied into a hundred of different spirits, doing all kinds of different things. And immediately after that, I think it might have been a week or two after that, I started my first spirit school and realized that is what the Father's called me to. Mm-hmm. Are you guys okay?
Yeah.
So if He has called you to do specific things, then I need to understand that it will be a good idea for you as the Son of God to do only that which He's called you to do. If Yeshua walked the earth and only did what He saw the Father do, then what are we doing? Because we are not doing only what we see the Father do, we're doing what someone else is telling us to do. I see people always and many, many times getting worn out. Now I understand as you get older, wherever your perception is, whatever you're doing, it's possible to get worn out. I understand that. But I've only been doing it for, what, 13 years? And I've never not one day been worn out. Now before, I wouldn't want to go because I'm thinking to myself, there's 3,000 people, and I made a mistake in this one meeting, and I said, well, all the leaders come forward and I'll pray for you in a church of 3,000. So 350 people come forward, and I have the mentality, well, I have to prophesy over all of them. So 4 o'clock that morning, I realized, wow, I don't want to do this anymore. This is hard work. For R1,000, that's $60. I'm thinking I would rather be with my family and do personal training. Because that was my occupation. Because that was not my scroll. I didn't want to do that. But when the Father started showing me what I wanted to do and what He's called me to, all of a sudden my whole being is aligned with exactly that. And everything falls into place. Everything. I begin to see the angels that is assigned to my life. I begin to, and I've met the angel that's assigned to my bloodline. I begin to walk with them and work with them. He brings revelation to me, and He brings an understanding and a knowledge of what to say so that it makes sense to those who listen to me. Yeah, thank you. Because sometimes it doesn't make sense to me. But I believe it makes sense to you, because this is what he does. It's what he assigned to. It's not just assigned to me. It's assigned to Claire and to all my children. And the bloodline. So it came from my bloodline. This is just what I perceive and what I know according to the Spirit. But it's because I've been aligned with him. Because I'm in this place where he can now pour everything into me. Because that's where I have to be. I can be doing works and good things. But if I'm not in that place where he has called me to be, then I'm going to miss everything he pours into me. Because he's letting it go here, but I'm standing over here. That's another dimension of righteousness. In right standing, which means I'm in the exact right spot where I'm supposed to be so that he can pour into me exactly what I need for that which he's called me to.
Come on.
Are you guys okay?
Yeah.
And I want to go into the book of life. We all know about the book of life, but really the idea is that I have to understand that for me to walk in all that which he has for me, my sight is the most important. And I do not go or enter into the book of life because I'm born again. How many of you know that? I enter into the book of life because of my decision to live for Christ. Now, you might have a different theory or theology regarding this. That's your problem. But I get saved, and then I get born again. Salvation is when I meet Jesus. Getting born again is when I allow him full dominion and authority over this kingdom. When I allow him full dominion and authority over this kingdom, I begin to see. Because I know too many Christians that goes to church, pastors, teachers, evangelists, men of God that stands on platforms, that knows and that preach the gospel and lead thousands to Jesus, but they're not born again. And if the evidence of being born again is sight, then maybe some of us need to get born again. Don't look at me with that tone, I'm not joking. So if I'm born again, then my most important thing, other than the act of being born again, because I get born again through a decision I make in me to give completely and utterly over to him, in lordship, dominion, and authority, then something in me shifts. There's a dimension of me that now literally is poured into all of me. So third strand of DNA that's added. Because before I get born again, I'm under the angels. Then I get born again, and then the angels are under me. Because only once I'm born again am I restored into the image. That's the third strand of DNA that's added to me. You got the cap?
Yeah.
I'm not making this stuff up. Somewhat. I really believe that in the season of the Father's desire for you is to engage him in a different dimension. Now let's think about it. We always say change, change, change. But how many of us really changed? I mean, I'm not saying that he brought this because he did it. I clearly, extremely clearly saw this would be demonic, the flood. But how many understand he brought a change?
Yes.
Because you have to mentally shift your way of thinking to understand that it's really not about building. You're in a Lutheran church.
And you're here with us.
Yeah. I don't think that in a natural circumstance you'd be able to preach this in a Lutheran church. But something has changed.
Yeah.
And I don't even understand, change is like a holiday. Is that the saying you have in America? No? In South Africa, it's a saying, change is like a holiday. It literally means that if you just begin to understand and see things from a different perspective, you can, in a different angle, then everything starts looking differently. And of course, the Father wanted you to begin to see that it's not about coming to a building. It's realizing that I'm the ecclesia, and the fact is that I am to govern the earth. Now, I know we can do things corporately, and of course, there's more power corporately than individually, But if I know what to do, how to do it, where to do it, you know how to do it, what to do, where to do it, you, and we come together with that knowledge, imagine how we can shift and change the earth. If one takes down 1,000, two takes down 10,000, imagine what 50 people in a room can do. But I have to know what I'm called to, and you have to know what you're called to. Corporately, we're called to cast out demons, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, heal the sick. But what are you individually called to do? And I'm being trained and equipped, and the Father has gotten me to a place where I've slain four dragons and a giant. I don't even know where that comes. I've heard Ian talk about it, and let me tell you, if you hear Ian talk about it, it's not good. Because he says, don't do it. Don't think because you hear me do it, you can go do it. Because you will get your butt whooped. But not one of these times that I want to, not once that I walk to and fro seeking. I was taken into the spirit realm where I saw clearly exactly what needed to happen. And then from there I was taken in by the Spirit leading me because I'm in training. I didn't know that it would have such an effect on the region that we're in. I didn't know that it will change the whole of Louisiana to the dimension that it has. Now let me tell you, I know for a fact that there's more sons and daughters bringing change through what they're doing, legislating the kingdom into the earth and the dimensions that's being changed by the sons of God, and it's awesome. But I didn't know that that's what I was called to. Matter of fact, 5 years ago, I was still binding Satan. I haven't spoken to him outside of the courtroom in a very long time. But he hasn't been in my house for a very long time. We had a sniff of him on Friday. When my son was bitten by a spider, we believe it's a recluse spider, you know what that is. Yes. It's a nasty little thing, it makes a big bubble, and it doesn't just pop, it keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And some other stuff happened. And we just immediately went to the courtroom, right there in the kitchen. And within minutes, started heating up completely. The bubble's not full of water anymore, it's completely emptied out, really drying up. Everything else just falls into place. Because I am beginning to realize who I am in Christ. I'm beginning to understand that this is a battle that I don't have to fight.
Come on.
It's not a war that I have to try and win. It's already been dealt with. It's already been won. The enemy is defeated and disarmed. No matter what how I look at it, in whichever way, he has lost his power. If I look at it in the natural, he's got no feet and he's got no arms. Defeated, disarmed. If I look at it in the spiritual, then he has lost his power. So no matter which side I'm at, I'm either looking at a worm that's 7,000 years old, or I'm looking at something that's under my feet, something my toe jam. There's no way out for him. He's literally a Mickey Mouse puppet that I can no longer be afraid of in any way, fashion, or form. Only if I live in the flesh. Because in the flesh, he comes to kill, steal, and destroy. In the flesh, he can see me. In the flesh, he hates me. But in the spirit, where I live, rule, and have my complete and utter domain, he can't even get there. The only time he can see me is when I call him into the courtroom, where he has brought accusations against me in the earth, where I call him into the courtroom and I say, I repeat those accusations. And I remind you, the courtroom is rigged. He stands no chance. The only time that he wins is when there's no man in that courtroom, flesh. You guys okay?
Yeah.
I don't even know how long I've been going at this. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may recompense for his deeds in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. I want to remind you, it's not talking about sin yet. Because the Son of God, me and you, the sons and daughters of the Most High, we have already been judged. Because our sins is destroyed, nullified through the blood of Yeshua. So the Father, in every dimension of heaven, the King of heaven, looks at me through Christ. Because I'm dressed in Him. Do you guys understand that?
Yes.
I'm dressed in Him. I'm one with Him. So when the angels, when the four living creatures, when the seven spirits, when any form of living creature in the kingdom of heaven look at me, they see me dressed as Christ. So this good and bad is what I was called to do. Are you doing what you have been assigned to do, or are you just doing works of iniquity? Are you trying to please man? Listen, excuse me, Gustav, we're going to New Orleans to go pray for people in the streets. Do you want to come join us? Hell no! I don't know if we have to go. But yeah, sure. I mean, yeah, Pastor, I'll come. Of course I'll do it, yeah. But I won't be able to do it today. Gustav will not be able to do it. It's not on my scroll. And do I have the boldness to say that? A gentleman phones me the other day and says, listen, I need you to come preach for me. No. He didn't understand it. He couldn't perceive that. And the Father said to me, I can do it. But then in the same way, I said, why do you want to eat something that's not on your plate? I was in a church service. It is a rehabilitation center. I did go there a couple of times, but I enjoyed it. You know what? There's nothing more fun than preaching a message and halfway through you have to bind, cast out a demon or freak out on somebody. It's a lot of fun. You know, just shifting the atmosphere. By the way, the preacher, you don't get to do that in church all that often. But it was fun, but I realized very quickly that I didn't want to do it anymore because the Father's really dragging, not dragging me, kind of, yeah, grabbing by the hair. Come, son. Taking me to a place where I literally want to only do what He calls me to do.
That's good.
Where I literally don't do anything because man tells me to do it. I have to shift into that place where I'm 100% aligned with what He has for me. And that will not exclude the fact that I will be part of a body of people. It will not exclude the fact that I have to study the Word, that I have to pray and seek His face and worship. It will not exclude the fact that I need to constantly be in the Spirit and spend an intense amount of time with Him. He has to become my best friend. He has to be the one that I want to be with more than anybody else in my life. But in the same breath, I need to get to the place where I can be with Him all day and still be a normal person on the earth. Because how many understand before I got born again, I could do that. I could be a normal person on the earth, but I didn't have a spirit. Now that I have a spirit, my spirit can do whatever it needs to do, and my soul and my body can function as a normal person. But when night comes, when I go to bed, it is my soul's responsibility to go into the kingdom of heaven with my spirit. And that comes with training. I struggle with that even still today. But I do it. I feel it happening often. Not as often as what I would like it to happen, because I still don't understand the concept of the night watch all that much. But I'm beginning to, because it's a process of training, a process of growth, a process of revelation. And I still have to get myself to the place where my soul and my body is completely and utterly subject to my spirit. But it's all a process of growth. Now, it doesn't have to be a process of growth. But because of what has been shaped us, and because of what has formed us, and because of who we are through revelation, through perceptions, and through theology, and what we were taught, and what we were believed, or what we believed, we had to go through some stuff. Because if I read my destiny scroll, are you guys still okay?
Yeah.
So I read my destiny scroll, there's no sickness and disease on it. There's no frustrations and irritations. There's no tests. There's no trials on it whatsoever. Matter of fact, it's given to me perfect. My destiny, my purpose is given to me spotless. It's only when it's been given to me that it all of a sudden turns into a mess. Sometimes Satan has nothing to do with that. And we're pretty good at messing up stuff all by ourselves.
Praise God.
Right? But let's think about it. If by the time I get my destiny scroll, I have been born into a family where this is revelation to them, As I was mentioned, this generation, me and you, might be going through this very roughly. But the next generation, there has to be something smooth for them.
Yes.
Because they get to be taught from the very beginning.
Yes.
When you're 3 years old, don't shift. Stay in that realm and allow me to teach you from there, audibly, how to go and get your scroll at the age of 3. It happened to me at the age of 37. It had its effects. I mean, that's about 13 years of theology. I did my bachelor's, 2 years of Rhema, 3 years of Bible school through my own mother church, 4 years of Acts International, that's Israel Bible School, and then 1 year at Bethel. But it was the same Bethel here in Reading, but it's in Cape Town. That's 13 years of studying the Bible and the Word of God. To have a revelation given that is the complete opposite of all that. But then in the same breath, not to just throw all of that out, but to begin to take the truth, putting it in that, because that's the truth through man's perception, which kind of makes it a lie, but I can change it. Right? You guys okay? So slowly but surely, I truly believe that in this time and in this season, and I still hate saying time and season, because I really believe that the Father, through giving us dominion over the earth, has also given us the ability to be over time and space. You know, so even when I speak or prophesy over people, I seriously try not to say this is your time and your season. That your season is coming to an end. It's just out of habit that we say these things. Because subconsciously, I still believe you have to die. So this is your season. So in 10 seasons later, you're 104, and you're probably going to die at 105. That's just our subconscious way of thinking. But when I begin to step out of that perception of seasons and time, and I go into the Spirit and bring all of that reality into this place, I begin to understand that nothing has to have a time, nothing has a season. Me, Gustav Le Roux, is just shifting deeper in to the heart, hands, and a life of God. And that is beginning to reflect in my today. That is literally changing to the supernatural all the time.
Come on.
Are you guys okay?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
I want to remind you that we are the light bearers of the earth. Which means everything Yeshua was on the earth, we are. He is the light. That makes me the light. He is the door. He is the key. That makes me the door, and it makes me the key. But don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying I'm God. But I'm definitely going to be a God. Now, there's no way I can walk around this. It's impossible. Just like Paul said, I can't step out of that mentality because, let me remind you, my daddy is God. God makes gods. That's just how it works. Now, I don't want to speak of that because I can already see your depression in growing, because there's a instantly. But I need you to understand it is a mental shift that needs to take place. Because I'm no longer mere human. I'm a superhuman, if that's my mentality, but I have to even go behind that. I am a spirit being. I have literally changed creation. I'm not what I used to be. And I remind you of one thing. Jesus, if he was the seed, and I'm going to understand he was the seed. He was the second Adam. So he literally had to do what he did so that there could be a whole different creation birthed out of him. Now if I have an apple seed in my hand and I have an apple in my hand, how many of you know these two does not look the same? I can eat the apple seed, it will be disgusting and bitter. But I eat the apple and it's juicy and sweet. But yet, this came from this. So in essence, I'm not even like Jesus. I am the enhanced super version of who he was. Can we begin to understand that? Because his desire for me is to see that I can do great things. Because he did some things in the earth that was phenomenal, but we forget the 40 days. The 40 days was the key to everything that's mine. The last 40 days when he was completely restored in the earth of God. And he was completely glorified. So much so that when Thomas put his hand in his side, everything changed for Thomas. The miracles that came from his hand was completely mind-boggling. Beyond what we can even begin to fathom. It's not written down in the Bible, but if you go do a historic study on it, you'll begin to see that he did some phenomenal things. Why? Because he went in. He went in before anything was. He went into where I'm supposed to come out of. He went into that realm and dimension that I now have access into. And the Father's desire for me is to go live and move and have my being there. Because I said this now, I'll see if I can close with this. And I've said this before, but how many of you have ever seen a birth? Other than that, that's disgusting. It's beautiful. It's like one of those things you go, it's really disgusting and wonderful and beautiful and nasty and wow, seriously? Baby came out there, oh my God. It's just mind-blowing. But before any form of birth took place, there was blood and water. So it's almost like, you know, when there's blood and water, there's going to be a birth. And it's always the law of first mention. I mean, out of Adam's side came the bride, and so the second Adam, the same thing had to happen. So out of the side of Yeshua came the bride, right? So we can begin to understand that that was really just an access, a porthole that opened for the sons and the daughters to have access in and out like Enoch. Enoch just grabbed hold of it before it actually happened because of the vertical timeline, not horizontal. Because it's like the first. It makes a full circle. Whatever happened in the beginning has to go all the way around so it happens again. So the beginning is really the end, but the end is really the beginning. But in the same breath, it goes beyond Adam and Eve. Because I don't want to be like Adam. Because he could sin. He could make a mistake. But the Father says the fivefold is going to train and equip the saints to perfection. Where they will not make mistakes. Where we will live so close and so intimate with him that I will not do anything outside of him doing it. I will not say anything outside of him saying it. I will not be anything outside of him being it. Literally, I will be in him in a full dimension and all of that which he brings to the reality that I walk in through the kingdom of heaven where me and him will co-heir everything. See, I really believe, and I'm going to close with this, the Father's desire for us is to see who we really are. Because there's some things out there that can get us to believe that we're really awesome. That we are wonderful, but you can't do anything outside of Christ. Now, that's logic. You can't do anything outside of Christ. Matter of fact, the idea is not that I can't do anything outside of Christ. The desire of the Father is that you get to the place where you realize that you don't want to do anything outside of Christ.
Amen.
T.D. Jakes makes a statement, and I'm sure you've heard it. If they can leave, let them leave. Have you heard that? Like he was talking about pastors and leaders freaking out whenever somebody leaves, whenever leaves the church, people leave the church, and it's painful. And have you ever, you know, a pastor would say, a wolf will rip my arm off, but it won't even hurt. But a sheep will just bite me, and it will be painful for the rest of my life. And I never understood that until I became a pastor. Help me, Jesus. But it was just like that. It was that bad. And very quickly the Father had to teach me that if they can't leave, they're not joined to you, let them leave. And the Father is getting his sons and his daughters to that place where they begin to realize, if I can leave him, let me go. But his desire for me is to be so intimately and so one with him that I cannot step out of his will. I cannot step out of anything that he doesn't have already established for me in the perfect world that is aligned for me according to what I agree to. But I have to go into that place. And I have to go get my destiny scroll. I have to begin to enhance my sight so it can grow to its fullness. So So that what I see right now is exactly the same way as what I see in the Spirit. Let's stand. You guys okay? Yes, I'll pray in tongues a little bit. Just let what I said just go through your spirit a little bit. Maybe some of the stuff I said you didn't grasp all that nice. Maybe some of the stuff just sounded ridiculous. Maybe some of the stuff was just like kindergarten and was too easy for you to understand. And maybe sometimes you just think, oh, I don't even know what to talk about at all. And that's also okay. You know, you're strong and powerful enough to believe anything and all things. You know, and we are not gathering around some teaching or some man. We're gathering as a family, one that loves each other. We are one in the Spirit. We stand together. And we have great power when we come together. So I want you to just meditate on some of the things that were said today. I want you to get you to that place where you have an intense desire to become one with the Father, when you provide a soul and spirit. You're in that place in your life where you really just want everything He has for you. You don't want to make mistakes. You don't want to step out of His perfect will. You don't want to do anything that is uttered to you by man. Although it might still be part of your training, and then let it be. It won't stress you. It won't bother you. But when you no longer want to do what man allocated for you, because you know it's not what's on your plate, and you know what you're Father's heart, you don't have to eat what's not in your plate, then let's begin to focus and get yourself to a place where you hear all that which He's pouring into you, because you're one with Him. Where His voice is not something He's audible, but His voice is in you, just like my voice is in me. So Father, right now, in the name of Yeshua, I'm going to bring your sons and your daughters before your throne. Every one of them, Father, precious, beautiful, absolute, phenomenal, powerful beings, Father. Some in this room have gone through some hectic stuff the last couple of months, Father, but you've been faithful and you've been lifting them up. Father, there's some mental restoration that needs to take place, Father. There's some intense depression that hangs over your people. I can feel it. It needs to go. Lord, there's some irritation, there's some frustration, there's a lot of anger, and it needs to go, Father God. And I know there's a lot of stress financially, and Lord, I pray that you will lift up right now in the name of Yeshua everything that's not of you. As a matter of fact, I want to go into the courtroom with you guys right now before we do anything else. I want you to start picturing the courtroom. I want you to sit, because I believe the Father has already allocated a courtroom for this time. I wasn't sure whether we're going to go in or not, but I believe that He has. And what I need you to do is I need you to bring yourself before Him right now. There's been intense and serious accusations made against you. Now, while the accusation is ringing through your head, I need you to start calling in the demonic that is making the accusations. Now, no Satan's in the court, because he's always busy making accusations against the saints. But I'm looking at sickness and disease. I'm looking at depression, frustration, irritation. I'm looking at an extreme excessive anger towards God. I'm looking at a lack of understanding. And it's a feeling that just hovers over the people that is almost hopelessness. So what I really believe, we need to bring all of this into the court right now. I want you to go there with me. I want you to see Him as the judge. I want you to see the seven spirits as your witnesses. I want you to see Yeshua as the advocate in the room. I want you to see that 100 million angels around His throne. I want you to see the four living creatures. I want you to see that which Ezekiel 1 and Ezekiel 10 talks about as it comes into the earth. I want you to begin to just have your eyes opened. And immediately, according to what the Word says, we agree with the accuser. Now, most of the time, I don't want to agree with him, but I know the accusations, and fine, I agree with him. I don't agree in the earth. But in the Spirit, the Word says to agree, I agree with the accuser, and immediately we ask the Father for forgiveness, and we repent. We ask for forgiveness, and we repent. Now I want to remind you of something, because the judgment of the Father happens and takes place over His sons and His daughters in a different way than what it does over the demonic and over anything and everything that's not under His covering. Because I'm under His covering, because I'm in Him, because of the blood of Yeshua, because of Him being my head and me being in Him, His judgment over me, and I want you to start feeling it right now. It lifts you up, it propels you, it blesses you, it cleanses you, it brings healing to you, it lifts you deeper into Him, and it literally shakes you into the fullness of your destiny. His judgment over you is life. Amen. His judgment is to propel you and to lift you higher. So that's what we feel right now, Father. I want you to experience it. You know, I need to also bring it across. It's not about what you feel. It's not about feelings. It's not about the shaking and the laughing and the falling. It's really about the spirit man going in and experiencing it and bringing that reflection to the earth. Back into my soul and into my body. And as you felt that judgment, I want you to be reminded, I want you to look at every demon in that room, every demonic word that was spoken against you, every form of depression, sickness, every financial lack, every feeling that you know is ripping you apart, every dimension that the enemy has brought to you, every plan that is laid down at your feet. I want you to see it, and I want you to be reminded that the same judgment that gave you life just now, that same judgment over the enemy that's not over him, that's not covered by him, that's not in the blood, anything and everything that's not covered by Yahweh, that's not in his blood, that's not protected by him, that judgment nullifies and destroys. It literally destroys, nullifies, and there's an intense eviction that comes over all that was oppressing you. I want you to see that freedom. I want you to see what the courtroom does. And then to bring it to an even higher place, the Father has signed an eviction against the enemy. That is papers that you have at hand. Whenever the enemy wants to come back, bringing the same accusations that's been dealt with in the court today, he has no power. Amen. And I remind you that you have the angelic canopy assigned to you. At least I have at least three angels, and I know there's more because they are just all over the place. But I had a friend of mine say that a minimum of 15,000 angels to every human on the planet. Minimum. Then to the sons of God, there might even be more allocated. But in the same breath, I'm a son in the house of my Father. All of his servants to my beck and call, according to the mandate that the Father has set out for me. Yes. So I need you to understand that what happened today in this courtroom nullifies the work of the enemy.
Yes.
It brings dimensions of favor and elevates you, lifts you up, brings you to a clarity of thought, and it enhances your spirit and it lifts you higher into deeper realms of the Father. Father, we just want to praise and worship you right now. We glorify you. And I know that protocol might be different for everybody. I have just stepped into this. And so my protocol might be different. And it will still change as I go deeper. But this is what I felt in my heart to do. This is the way I do it. And I know it changes every time I do it because I grow deeper into it. And I know that the Father's mercy and grace passes all over in everything. He is extremely gracious with us because no one really knows exactly how to do it. Of course, if you've been doing it for a longer time, you might have different things to say. Yes. But I need you to understand, I have seen the power of the mobile court and it shifts and changes everything. I've seen cancer go. I've seen phenomenal lives change. Matter of fact, I had a gentleman come visit my meeting the other day, and he literally only came to the meeting because the Father told him that I would lead him into the court of scrolls because he had a meeting to attend where he had to preach a certain message in front of the entire nation on a TV station and didn't know exactly what he wanted to say. The three of us went into the court of scrolls, and he received a message directly from the Father's hand, and he came back. It was just absolutely phenomenal. He preached that message on international TV, and he spoke to me the other day, said it was just absolutely phenomenal. He had open door to say whatever he wanted to say. And he has the same revelation as what I'm really ministering to you guys. The courts just changes and shifts everything. No longer have to bind Satan. I can, it's good, hard work. I have authority over him. I don't want you to think any other way. But I don't have to deal with him.
Come on.
So right now, Father, I just speak life over everyone in this room. I pray, Father, that your spiritual power and fire will begin to open their eyes to see. Every man, every woman, Father, for excessive sight. As we are born again, spirit beings, we need to see. So, Father, I speak that dimension of life into everyone in this room, Father God, for your spirit to enhance, for the dimensions to open up, and for you to pour into your sons and your daughters all that's needed for this time and season. In the name of Yeshua. Amen.